Hey guys, Chris here. In this video, we're gonna do something a little bit different. Today, we're reacting to a video by Shmi150. Shmi150 is one of the biggest YouTubers out there, has, you know, a ton of supercars, but last year he bought his first electric vehicle, a Porsche Taycan Turbo S. And today's video that we're going to react to is a video he uploaded just a few days ago called My Problems with Electric Cars Driving the Porsche Taycan Home. So he's been down to Germany, down to Nürburgring. He has a few cool videos up on that and his road trip. So I'm going to link his channel down below. I am a huge fan of Tim, known as Shmi150, but this video really got my attention. So in today's video, we're going to react to it. So guys, remember to hit that like button down below and also subscribe to the channel if you aren't subscribed already. Hi guys, I'm Shmi. Hello and welcome back to the channel, where today we continue the road trip heading back home with the Taycan from here at the Nürburgring with typical Eifel Mountains weather. It is very cold, it is very foggy, and it's also surprisingly noisy for 8 a.m. The track seems to already be up in operation, but today we're going to be heading just over 600 kilometers, just under 400 miles, to bring the Taycan back, which means a few charging stops along the way, a journey that by Google Maps would be about 7.5 hours. I think probably add one or two to complete it today, but I want to give you more of my thoughts about using an electric car for a road trip like this. We'll travel in total about 1,500 miles, 2,500 kilometers, and I've got some things that I've learned, some thoughts that I've gathered along the way that I'd like to share with you as we make our way back home.
Okay, so first I have to say the spec of Shmi or Tim's Taycan Turbo S, green with the gold accents, looks beautiful. I love it. It's a really cool spec. But also to give you guys some background, I am sitting in an Audi e-tron GT. I bought this car a month ago. I've covered 10,000 kilometers in the past month in this car alone. And a few days after I took delivery of this, I drove it all the way down to Germany, to Munich. I was down there for almost a week, driving on Autobahn all over the place, back and forth to Stuttgart and stuff like that, and then back home again. In the first week I had this car, week and a half, I did like 5,500 kilometers. So I do have some experience, and this car, for people who know, is very closely related to the Taycan Turbo S. This is just a normal entry-level GT, so this would be similar to a Taycan 4S. So it's not, you know, as high-powered as that, but, you know, it still has the same range. It has the same architecture, the same battery pack, the same charging speed. So I do have very similar, you know, experience as Tim with his, Taycan Turbo S. And also about a month before I took this car down to Germany, I took a Polestar 2 from Oslo down to Genoa in Italy and then back again. That was also like 5,000 kilometers in 5 days. And then I took it to the west coast of Norway and then back again. So I covered in these two cars on long trips in like the past 2 months, I've done like 12,000-13,000 kilometers. But also I've had an e-tron 55 for a year, done 26,000 kilometers in that car. And altogether, the past year, I've done about 120,000 kilometers in 35 different EVs. Long trips, short trips, all over the place. I've been to the Arctic Circle with a Mustang Mach-E, with a Tesla Buran. I do have quite, you know, some experience now in the past year. And that's the reason I wanted to react to this video. But okay, guys, let's continue.
The first thing to say though is how funny does the Taycan look like this with all of the dew over it and with some kind of reflective properties for the large panoramic roof, which always mean you get these rainbow colors going on, which is quite fun to be able to see. We will have to warm that up a little bit.
Yeah, I actually get the same on mine. Those rainbow colors is pretty interesting.
We have ahead of us. We've already loaded the car back up, and it is surprising how busy it is here, but hopefully it's not going to be too much of a nightmare journey as we make our way through Belgium to France, to the Eurotunnel, to cross back to the UK. We've got about 85% or so charge at the moment. We'll go down this way, head out past the Nürburgring Boulevard, and get this rather long journey underway. We're actually already down to 88%. Eyes will be closely on that today. And a few more thoughts as well about how much it depletes when you're driving on the Autobahn. I don't think we're going to have any Autobahn stretches today, but it is quite crazy to see as the charge gets lower, how much the Vmax decreases.
So I can just comment on this. So my last day of my trip to Munich with this car, I did a consumption test at 140 kilometers an hour in efficiency mode. That would be range mode in the Taycan, and calculated, you know, for heat loss and all of those stuff, this car would be able to do like 330 kilometers at 140 kilometers an hour. But going Vmax, Yes, that really depletes the battery. You know, because in Germany you have all of these construction areas, so you're going VMAX and then you're braking down and then you're going VMAX and then you're braking and then you're going VMAX. So you have a lot of these acceleration runs. But, you know, long story short, with the heat loss, which is immense at, you know, 250 kilometers an hour, this car was able to go like 150 to 170 kilometers, which is much less than 330. But still, it's not too bad.
I don't tend to start drives like this so early in the morning. I prefer to drive later into the evening than in the morning, but we actually need to get somewhere in London before they close today. So that's the mission. We're heading out now past the Nürburgring sign, down the Nürburgring Boulevard here, where everything is based, the GP track just alongside us. So we expect it to take probably an hour and a half, 2 hours extra, with about three charging stops. Obviously planned it out all a little bit in advance to use the...
Yeah, so an hour and a half, 2 hours of charging to go 600 kilometers. No, that doesn't sound right at all. I've done a trip of about 600 kilometers with this car, you know, going, let's say, at a steady 140. Yeah, you can cover, again, he's not starting from a full battery, but you can do one charging stop, like half an hour, if you want to charge it almost all the way to like 95%, maybe 90-95%. But if you go two short charging stops, you can do it in like, I don't know, 20-25 minutes. This car charges really fast, like 10-80% in like 18 minutes. The best charging session I had in Germany was 3-80% in like 20 minutes. So that sounds a bit too much, like an hour and a half, 2 hours. No, it doesn't sound right at all.
Rapid charges, so we want to get it as low as possible, ideally so that we get the fastest charging time. We've got 147 kilometers to our first charging stop. We're at the first charging stop then. We should have, I think, three charging stops today. We've actually got 39% left.
Yeah, that's kind of strange. Why would you stop with 39%? You know, throughout Europe, I haven't driven in Belgium, but I've driven in Sweden, Denmark, Germany, Austria, Italy, Switzerland, and he's using Ionity chargers because if you buy a car with, you know, which is part of the Ionity group, to say it in that way, you will get a charging card which will give you a discounted price. So, and also Ionity have, they are 350 kilowatt chargers, all of them, so you'll get maximum speed when you have a Taycan or an e-tron GT. But what I experienced is that, especially like in Western and Northern Europe, they are placed somewhere in between 80 to 100 kilometers in between. So him having 118 kilometers left, that's based on his recent driving. He would have been fine to go to the next charging station to top up. He would have saved himself a few minutes in charge,
which is showing as 118 kilometers, and I'm pretty sure that would have been fine to make it to the next one. But basically I want to split up, I guess, during each of these charges into three different things I'd like to talk about. The first is our experience of taking the car on a road trip and the best ways to do it. The second is how the UK compares to France, Germany and Belgium, where we've been charging. And the third are some more of my thoughts about electric cars in general, some things that I think might surprise you, but we'll get to that a little bit later. So for the moment, basically the best thing that you can do when you're taking an electric car on a road trip is firstly plan for hotels that have a charger, because there is nothing more convenient than waking up with 100%.
Yeah, so I totally agree with Tim here. Again, when I went down to Italy with the Polestar 2, I planned, you know, if it is possible, you know, as much as possible, try to plan for hotels where you can park the car and then you can charge it overnight. And, you know, waking up in the morning with a full charge, it's like driving a gasoline car or diesel car and then you have a full tank of fuel. It's really nice. Just starting, you don't have to stop before for many hours. So, and it also makes the trip faster, because what's the advantage with having an EV is that you can charge while eating, you can charge while sleeping, you can charge while going to the toilet. If you have a petrol car or a gas car or a diesel car, you have to stand there and you have to fill. Yes, it is a few minutes, but just having the convenience to do that, you don't have to think about it. So I totally agree with Tim here.
As we've been able to do, I think, pretty much every day. In fact, every single day, basically. So that's made it a lot easier. The second is that when you're planning along the way, you want to do a lot of short, sharp fill-ups, effectively. Like this, after 100, 150 kilometers, top it up for 10 minutes.
Yeah, I wouldn't do that. Like 100, 150 kilometers on a motorway or Autobahn or through Belgium, that's like every hour, 10, 15 minutes. That's, for me, that's too frequent. you could easily go 2 or 3 hours with this car. It charges so fast, as I said, like from 10 to 80%, an 80% charge at this speed would give you at least like 250, maybe 300 kilometers of range. So stopping every 2-3 hours and charging for like 18 minutes, that's the way I would do it, and the way I did it when I went down to Germany. Driving on Autobahn is a bit different. If you want to go VMAX, you're going to be charging every 150 kilometers, but then you're going flat out. You're not doing that in Belgium and in other countries.
And on you go again, it makes things much easier than trying to do a 0 to 100%. That's where it becomes very inefficient and takes a lot longer to charge. Plus, this means you get to stretch your legs every now and then, and we will literally be here because it's only 147 kilometers to the next one for probably 5 to 10 minutes at most before we continue. So it's not really much of a hold up, but obviously this is where I jump out and make some little video clips talking to camera, so it might look like...
Sure. And I experienced that at all. I've done the same thing. If you've seen my videos throughout Europe, the same thing, hopping out. And when you're filming a YouTube video like this, you have to, you know, turn on your mics, you have to turn on your camera, you have to position yourself. Maybe there's a truck passing, you have to wait. Maybe people are passing, standing in the background, you want a clean shot, and then suddenly, wow, 5 minutes. And then you have to shoot your clip. And then, like, maybe you made a mistake, you have to shoot it again. Suddenly, like, oh, it's 10 minutes. I have 5 minutes or 4 minutes to go to the bathroom and pee. So yeah, it's interesting.
Part owned by Porsche, you get the charging card with the car, which is effectively worth a couple of £100, euros, dollars, whatever it is per year subscription. And after a couple of years, that expires.
Yeah, so this is true, but it's a bit disappointing that he's not actually giving the actual pricing. So this subscription service, or this card you get with purchasing, you know, a Volkswagen product car or an Hyundai, Kia, Ford, and also BMW are all part of the Ionity charging service network. You get this card. The first 12 months, it's free. But after that, you have to pay a monthly subscription, which is 20 euros. And depending on how much you use the Ionity chargers, it will make economic sense or not. But the pricing isn't too bad. So most of Europe, it's 35 euro cents per kilowatt hour. And then in Norway, it's even cheaper. It's like 0.18 euro cents per kilowatt hour. So you easily, you know, make that up in the subscription if you just drive enough. Because going to other chargers like the ENBVs and also the EONs are like 50 euro cents per kilowatt hour, which is pretty expensive. And also, if you don't have even an Ionity app, you're not registered, it's like 0.85 euro cents per kilowatt hour. Really expensive.
So it's very hard to calculate, but it does mean you get a discounted rate. Nonetheless, it's still actually quite expensive. It's not almost a zero cost as you might think, and that's before it's all taxed, and we'll touch more on this later on. The one charge I did at a much more expensive third-party charger, but also a rapid charger like these, was, well, near on kind of 60-70% of the equivalent per mile or kilometer of filling up a V12, let's say like in my Ferrari GTC 4 Lusso that I owned before. So we'll wait for this to finish up and then we'll get back on the road.
Yeah, so that's an interesting comment. So if you go to a third party, you're using it, you know, maybe you're not even registered, you're doing SMS payment. It's still, as he said, almost half the price as filling up a V12 Ferrari, which this Taycan Turbo S will, you know, outrun any day of the week. So quite an interesting comment, but I also did a calculation on my trip to Italy and back again. I haven't done it on this yet. I'm going to get that video out, guys. But this is more fuel efficient, or uses less electricity per kilometer than the Polestar 2 in my experience on the Autobahn. But the trip I did with the Polestar 2, and that's going VMAX 2 days, or at least one of the days through Germany, it came out cheaper than like a Polo diesel. And that car has 3 times the power, more space. So it's, yes, it's not free, but it's not expensive either. It's still going to be cheaper than a diesel car.
Jump ahead and we are immediately at the next fast charger, significantly busier, in fact very busy at the services where we are right now. And as we pulled up, there was a combustion engine car parked in the electric car space, and we kind of needed to use one where we can plug in on the left side as opposed to the right. They did thankfully move over very quickly, so we were able to get plugged in, get charging, and we're currently building up the percent very quickly. It was going at 250 kilowatts from about 22%, but our next charge is actually going to be in the UK. So going from here to the Eurotunnel across to the UK will get us about 160 kilometers to the next charger. So again, we don't need to get up to 100%, but with the tunnel crossing, we are going to take it to about 80 maybe or so, given we've got the time. And it's actually quite a nice day here in Belgium. Now, talking about charging experiences in different countries, this is something that you might have seen from my videos before. Now, in the UK, I have frequently struggled to find chargers that aren't out of order, having technical issues, completely full with long queues.
Yeah, so this is an interesting comment. I have heard other people in the UK say that the network is terrible, faulty charger. So I think I'm going to have to do a trip to the UK very soon, maybe this side of Christmas or New Year's. If I'm lucky, I'll have to plan that. But I really want to experience the UK network, because as he said, in like I went in the middle of the common holiday in Europe in the end of July, while, you know, most of Europe was on holiday. And because of Corona, people weren't traveling, you know, out of Europe. People were actually traveling in Europe. And a lot of cars on the road, a lot of people at service stations, queues at the gas and diesel pumps, but no queues at all with the, you know, the Ionity chargers. I had one instance when I got down to Italy, you know, the day three, about 100 kilometers before I got to Genoa, charging at an Ionity station outside of Milan. There was a Taycan charging. One of the chargers were out of order, so they were three working and they were all occupied. But I waited for like, I don't know, it must have been like 3 minutes before I was able to charge. So I had that in Europe, like no queues, mostly no issues at all. But when I got back to Sweden, well, you know, more issues. And then I got back into Norway. Here we have a lot of chargers. I'm actually charging now, doing two things at once. Charging at this 125 kilowatt charger. There's a 150 next to me, but I don't want to charge too fast because I want to preserve the battery. But okay, let's watch more of this.
We need to wait and find one in exactly the right place. You know, we've been able to shuffle our journey, let's say, to go to chargers, depending where they actually are, and that's made it a lot easier. Now, Germany was super smooth. There are multiple different companies with these rapid chargers. The UK at the start of this year, I think, had about six rapid charger locations in basic, or Ionity chargers. In
that, to me, is insane. Six rapid chargers. Is that six 150 kilowatt charger stations? Is that six 200 kilowatt charger stations? Or is that six 350 kilowatt charger stations? Like 10% of you guys watching my videos are from the UK, so please drop me a comment down below and educate us. Is that true? Six rapid chargers? And what does he mean by rapid charger? Is that 150 kilowatt or is that 350 kilowatts?
Rapid charger locations in basic, or Ionity chargers in pretty much the whole country, which is obviously not the ideal scenario. So this has been an interesting thing to learn and experience and see how it's done differently from one place to the other. Some of them have been a bit of a faff to try and find. Most are like this, just next to the services, but some have only been on one side of the highway, not on the other, and that's meant a lot of backwards and forwards and wasted time and wasted mileage. But obviously, as all of this improves, that's going to get better. So that's been my experience of this so far from that point of view. But from here, we will head to the Eurotunnel, over to the UK, and when we're charging up for the next time, I want to give you some more of my actual thoughts about owning, living with, and using an electric car. Amusingly, we had a little bit of wait in the queue, pulled up here, smugly thinking, hey, we don't need to queue to get to a petrol pump. We'll have charged for 15 or 20 minutes by then. But unfortunately, for some reason, and it is quite ironic being back in the UK that it happened immediately, we went to the first machine, the end one, that was out of service, went to the second one, and it wouldn't authorize my charging card. Came to the third one, and it still wouldn't authorize my charging card. Got on the help service, called them up, and they effectively remotely rebooted this machine. And then immediately after the reboot, it started working. So we did waste 10 minutes, but eventually we got there.
Okay, this is pretty interesting because I see a pattern here. Again, when I went down to Germany, to Italy, and then back again, no issues with charging at all. Before I got to Switzerland, to the Ionity charging station at Gotthard, before the Gotthard Pass, I got to one charging station, one charger, it didn't work. Next one, it didn't work. And they were three chargers. So when I got to the third one, I was getting nervous because I was like very far away from any charger at the foot of the Alps. That luckily worked, but that was the only, you know, place on the trip where I had ABB chargers. I can see These are ABB chargers. Usually Ionity chargers are tritium or those other ones I don't know the name of, with the cable and the light overhead. But I've, you know, had a lot of trouble with ABB chargers. I have a friend who works with, you know, rapid charging. He says there are a lot of issues with ABB chargers. So are all of these charging issues in the UK due to you having a lot of, you know, ABB chargers? Do you have tritium chargers? Do you have, you know, the same problems there? Do you have delta chargers? This is a delta charger. Or do you have hyperchargers? In my experience, ABBs are, you know, almost every time there are issues. So again, if you live in the UK, let me know. I just thought that was interesting that the first time he's, you know, experienced a problem is at an ABB charger. So that may be the case. It's just the ABB chargers.
Jump ahead, the errand has been run. We made it in time and the Taycan is back here in the garage at home. The journey was about 9.25 hours. On Google Maps, it's about 7.5. That's not too bad, considering having to stop to charge a few times along the way. But what this whole journey has really taught me is that despite its very ambitious objectives, the UK has a lot of work to do. The reliability and infrastructure here, as I've tried to explain over the last year with the ownership of this car, it varies so much from one place to the next. But my experiences across the continent, at least in the three different countries that I've been charging, France, Germany, and Belgium, has been much more successful than I've had back here, which you've also seen in the videos that I've shot and uploaded along the way also. The future is certainly a very uncertain one. I think it's going to be interesting to see how all of this evolves, because I think we're still a long way away from being able to meet the targets that have been set. Of course, the manufacturers are all releasing EV after EV after EV, Audi, Mercedes, BMW, you name it, all of the others all working in this direction. I just hope we'll have some sort of exceptions for the small supercar manufacturers to keep the V12s, V10s, and V8s alive going into the future.
I agree.
These are really some incredible feats of engineering by the human race. So hopefully those won't be completely extinct as we go down the line. The Taycan, though, for this journey has served the purpose very well. It is parked here at the moment with the lift system up because I just couldn't be bothered to put it down, to be honest. So it's going to stay that way until I take it over to the Schmuseum. We're on about 40% of charge now, having covered many, many miles, about 1,500 miles, 2,500 kilometers. And we made it back today from the Nürburgring for about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, which is lovely by the time we've got home and done a couple of things around the town as well. That's it for now, though. Thank you very much for coming along for this adventure. The first EV road trip for me.
Okay, yeah. So his first EV road trip, actually, as he said. Also, he said 2,500 kilometers. That's the total trip from he started down to Germany and then back again. Today was only 600 kilometers. So yeah, I mean, that is very, very, very interesting. And as he says, you know, the charging network in the UK isn't very good. I don't know. I haven't been to the UK in maybe like 10 years. I haven't been to London. I want to go back. So maybe I'll take this car, another EV, to check out your charging network. But as he said, he had much better experience in the rest of Europe, and that is my experience also. I have charged in Germany, but also here in Norway. And I think Norway is a nice and interesting place for the rest of the world and also the rest of Europe to look. Because we're basically where a lot of the rest of the world was maybe like 7 or 8 years ago. But today, we have chargers almost at every corner. 70% of new cars sold here last month were EVs. More than 50% of all new cars sold last year were EVs. The big Audi e-tron was the best-selling car, period. So, you know, here it works. Again, we don't have too much high-speed, you know, motorways. We have a lot of slow country roads. That does, of course, help. But we do have cold winter, so, you know, that advantage is kind of offset a little bit by that, where EVs, you know, lose efficiency and all of that. But it is a very interesting video. I know this was quite a long video. I can see from the time that hopefully I edit this down to something that is bearable to watch. But I really wanted to do a reaction, a commentary on this video by Tim, because he's one of the few, maybe the only, like, huge and large YouTuber that has, you know, bought an EV and is doing similar content like me and Bjorn and other YouTubers. So guys, I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, please drop me a thumbs up down below. And for more car content, as always, guys, please subscribe. See you guys later and goodbye.